up at verse 7 tonight of the third chapter of Nehemiah, our study on the restoration of the wall, the restoration that God's doing in our lives and in the church. How many know He's still restoring and still rebuilding and still reviving? Amen. Praise God. We're not finished with what God started with. We've only just begun. Verse 7. We talked about the old things last week, and we need to redig the wells of Abraham that we did not need to remove the ancient landmarks that our fathers had set. So now the old gate has been erected, and next unto that, verse 7 said, repaired Melatiah the Gibeonite, and Gibeon, the men of the fight, the men of Gibeon and of Mizpah under the throne of the governor on this side of the river. Next unto him repaired Uzziel, the son of Harariah, the goldsmith. Next to him also repaired Hananiah, the son of one of the apothecaries. They fortified Jerusalem under the broad wall. And next unto them repaired Raphael, the son of Pur, the ruler of the half part of Jerusalem. And next unto them repaired Jediah, the son of Harumaph, even over against his house. And next unto him repaired Hathach, the son of Hasmoniah. Malchijah, the son of Aram, and Hashem, the son of somebody who died. Tahath Moab, he repaired the other piece as the tower of the furnaces. And next unto him repaired Shalom, the son of Halahash, the ruler of the half part of Jerusalem, he and his daughters. Let's stop at verse 12. Amen. Verse 7. Talking about who is doing the building, and it said that next to them repaired Melatiah the Gibeonite. Who remembers the Gibeonites? We preached about the Gibeonites just a few weeks ago. Who were the Gibeonites? They were the people in Egypt that did not want to be annihilated and destroyed, and so they deceived Israel, and they made a pact with Israel not to be destroyed. They were deceptive. But when Israel made the treaty with them, they were sealed, and it was cemented. And once you make a deal, you don't break the deal. Once you seal a deal, you pay your vows. They became slaves to Israel, but later on, they were made a part of Israel. They were drafted in and drafted in to the tribe of Benjamin. They became part of Israel. And I thought as I read this through, how interesting it is and how wonderful it is and how awesome it is that God can use people from one time or against him. Wow. I looked in the mirror when I read that verse. I saw my reflection when I read that verse. I thought of a man in the scripture whose name was Saul. But it was changed to Paul. Does anybody know who I'm talking about? Paul of Tarsus, who was on his way to Damascus to have the Christians thrown in jail and later to have them executed. Paul of Tarsus was a Hitler of his day. He didn't do the killing. He watched it done. He ordered it done and watched it happen. Kind of like what Hitler did. He put them in the concentration camps, and then he watched them burn in the furnaces that he had built for them. I met a woman who was in one of those concentration camps, and she told me of the horrific treatment that she had to undergo and how they would abuse them. And she saw Hitler get off the plane every single night. And I want to tell you, that's what Saul of Tarsus was. He was the Hitler of his day. He didn't execute them. He ordered to have them executed and watched it happen. there when Stephen was put to death. He was there when they stoned the first martyr for the cause of Christ. But on that great day, when he was on his way to do harm to the body of Christ and to fight against God, it was in that instant of time, in that moment of time, that God turned his life around and said, "You thought you were against me, but from now on you're going to be for me." But such were some of you, the Bible said. And I think what the listen tell that I looked at what it said, and it wasn't those things, but it said such were some of you. And I have to put myself in that picture as well. There do I, but for the grace of God. Amen. I want to tell you something. I'm so glad that God could take somebody who had been working against him and now is working for him. There was a day I worked for the devil. Yeah. There was a day that I was selling drugs. There was a day I was peddling booze. There was a day I was doing things that I'm not proud of and only to go into. I was working for Satan himself. But thank God, he said, "I'm going to grasp you in. I'm going to make you part of the family. I'm going to bring you on board. Amen. I'm going to use you for my glory." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, that's sound material tonight. That's not even the one of our verses that we're going to get into. That's going to make me shout tonight. Amen. I can identify with a Gideonite. I was a deceiver. I was a liar. I was a cheater. I was slipping around the corner, sneaking around the back, slipping out the door, going where I shouldn't go. Now, most of the time I got away with it because I was quick. There were times when I used to try to sneak out the door of a ticket to my car before he told me not to go. He tried to run out and grab my foil wire off the car so I couldn't start it. The one night that I got to the car before he did, I had an old TV Ford station wagon and an old beat up 429 under the hood. Amen. I ran out the door and I jumped in there before it got to the point of why, and I took off to see my girlfriend. Heading over a dirt road in the middle of the mountains up there in Alabama. I went tearing around a couple corners and I hit that gravel road, and all of a sudden it was just like ice cream, man. How many know what gravel does to a heavy automobile that can't make the turn because you're going too fast? I ended up in the crest. I had to walk back into town 4 miles in the dark out the middle of the woods, out the middle of the Adirondacks, with the bears and the wolves and the coyotes and everything else, and I'm 17 years, 16 years old, I think, at that time. I'm scared to death. Oh, I was not a good kid. But such was some of you. And I got past that, thank God, and God got a hold of me and he brought me back here. Aren't you glad God can fight in your past? Aren't you glad it doesn't matter where you've been, it matters where you're going, and God's concerned about where you're at? Amen. Hallelujah. Verses 8 through 11 go on to tell us about different people who begin to do the work of repairing, and it just gives a list in the first 9, which says, "And next to them repaired Raphael, the son of Phil, the ruler of the house of Jerusalem." This man was mayor of the town of Jerusalem. And down in verse 12, Melchizedek, the son of Aaron, Kesef, the son of Tahath-Moab, he repaired the other piece of the tower of Jerusalem. Verse 12, and next to him repaired Shalom, the son of Ahimaaz, the ruler of the half part of Jerusalem. He was the mayor of the other half of Jerusalem. So you have both mayors of Jerusalem working on the wall. How many know that God's work has room enough for politicians? It's not crooked work. Amen? How many know that God can use politicians? I think God can use Donald Trump pretty good. And I'm not even And if you read verses 8 to 11, you read the different ones. The goldsmiths were there, the apothecaries were there, those that made perfume, those that were the smiths, the goldsmiths. You had people working on the furnace room over there. I don't know, when you build a house, you got carpenters, you got masons, you got plumbers, you got electricians. You got a whole different realm of people working to get the thing done. I want to tell you, there's room for everybody to do work in the house of God. There's a job for you to do in the house of God. And when God gets ready to rebuild it, and He's already doing that here, as you continue in the rebuilding process, the restoration process, the revival movement that God is bringing, I want to tell you, He needs people to get on board and start doing their part. Amen? He needs people to get up and say, "Here am I. Lord, send me." Amen? Verse 12 is an interesting one, and this could get interesting tonight. The Bible said, "Next to him appeared Shalom, the son of Halahaz, the ruler of the half part of Jerusalem." And here's the part that we're going to talk for a little bit about. He and his daughters. Just a little sentence. He and his daughters. Very controversial subject. Women qualify for ministry in Israel where? I don't know if I have ever addressed this to something. But in a lot of churches, this becomes an issue. In a lot of places of worship, this becomes an issue. In revival movements, we need to abide by the Word of God, obey the Word of God, but we need to know the truth and not believe our own opinions. Amen? So I'm going to do my best to give you the Word of God tonight, not merely opinion, although I will share how I feel. I want to use the Word of God and examples from the Word and Scripture and biblical passages. You're living along in ministry. And that is the question of Jesus. Yes. Yes. No knows. Glad to hear there's no knows. He and his daughters work on the wall. Women do belong in ministry. The Bible said in Joel 2:28, "It shall come to pass, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. On my servants and on my handmaids, I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy." Amen. Without question, that was again uttered by Peter in the New Testament in the book of Acts. It was the fulfillment of the prophetic word given by Joel in the Old Testament. If you turn to Acts 21 and verse 9, you read that Philip had four daughters who were prophetesses. God uses women in ministry. Catherine Kuhlman was one of the greatest healing evangelists of modern times. A woman that God used mightily. There are a number of women through the years. I remember a great missionary in the Assemblies of God. She came to our house when I was a little boy. She came to our house when I was a pastor and my girls were little girls. Amen. She was a missionary to Malawi, Africa, and other parts of Africa for over 40 years, and it was Rose Cloud. And Rose would go over there to Africa. She would mix her own mud to make her own bricks. She would make her own bricks. She would drive her own truck and lay her own block and build her own church building. For 40 years, she spent her life giving to God. Amen? She spent her life of ministry, ministry as unto the Lord. Now, without question, God wants these women today in ministry. Amen? The real question is not about ministry. The real question is about leadership. And there we have to get very biblical. And we've got to talk about the role of the woman outside of ministry to understand the context of how she fits into ministry. Now, some of you may think, "Well, so where are we headed with this?" The Bible tells me that the man is the head of the woman, as Christ is the head of man, and God is the head of Christ. And the Bible says in 1 Timothy 2:12 that a woman is not to serve authority over a man. Say this. Most of you know that there's one week out of the year that I always go and preach a crusade. First week of November, every year I go preach a crusade. And the church I go preaching is pastored by a woman. So I want it clear, I am not against women in ministry, and I'm not against women in leadership. It becomes a little cloudy when you have a woman who is a senior pastor pastoring her husband. How can she be over him when the Bible says that he is over her? I do believe God does use women in senior pastors on occasion, but I believe it's the exception more than the rule throughout history. You'll find there were some senior pastors who were women, but not very many in the context of the totality of it all. Amen? If I read Judges, I read of 8 judges, I read only one woman, Deborah. She referred to herself as a mother in Israel. And one commentator said that's because Israel was behaving like children and needed a mother, so God gave them a woman. Because in those days, women had no place of authority, and God did it to save Israel because of the bad behavior. He gave them something that would make them a sin. Well, that was one commentator. That's not what I'm saying. Don't say pastor said that. But I do think that when it comes to leadership, it is possible for a woman to be a senior pastor. But it is very rare that a woman is a senior pastor because that puts her in a position over the man. The woman I preach for, by the way, is the mother of the man. So she's not over her husband. And that makes it really easy. Does that mean that a woman can't be a quote unquote pastor? No. I'm talking senior pastor. I'm talking about the lead pastor. It is the exception more than the rule that she would be the lead pastor. Can it happen? Yeah, God can do whatever he wants. But God has reasons for it. But we need women to stand up and serve, absolutely. Amen? I'm not a chauvinist. I'm not a bigot. I just read the Word of God, and I read where I see what God says in the relationship of a man and a woman. He made the man to be a leader. Now, this may be controversial that I'm about to say. I don't see co-pastoring in the Word of God. The two-headed monster is a freak. One of them has to be the lead. Although we use the term co-pastor, but one of them has to be the lead, because what happens if they disagree on an issue, which one, and it's not just a husband and wife team I'm talking about. I've seen two men come together in a church and co-pastor. It's not going to work. You have to have one leader. You can't have a co-pastor. We have staff pastors, and believe me, I listen to Pastor David, and I listen to Pastor Brendan. We sit down on Mondays. It's not me controlling them. I take their advice. Am I telling it right? Now, I'm the lead pastor. I'm the senior pastor, so I have that final say, but when we got a full pastoring, but we're not full pastors. You say exactly we have it. I told my staff in the last church, every time you want my job, they said, don't wait, pastor, that's why we do it. Because you don't believe pastor, that single God is front and takes the hits. You can't have two in the heaven. A two-headed monster is asleep. Amen. There has to be one leader. And so when you come down to that issue, there has to be a head. There has to be a leader. God will use women in senior pastorates and lead pastorates, but I believe, according to what I see in the Word of God, it is the exception, not the rule. Amen? Does that say that we are against women in leadership? No. We are not against women in leadership, but it better be God. Amen? And you better know it's God. Because God has set relationships, and He doesn't put man above a woman. He puts man equal with a woman. They see a man and female, but a different role. That's what I tell marriages all the time. Man, to love your wife as Christ loved the church, that means you die to yourself. Wives, submit to yourself and accept to be yourself as your husband as under the Lord. You submit to Him, but He has to die for you. So we're both really looking to benefit the other one more than ourselves. It's equality. It's not superiority. Men are not superior to women. Amen? Women are not superior to men. As much as this women's rights movement, it is very popular today, the right to make a woman over a man, and this men's chauvinistic nonsense, the right to make a man a ruler over a woman. I want to tell you, we're equal, but there's different roles and responsibilities that God gives. It is in that context that leadership comes to play. Women belong in ministry, absolutely, ladies. We cannot have ministry happen without women. It would not work. I thank God for my wife, but she'll be the first to tell you she's not the pastor. She's working with the ministry right now. She's already said it to a number of you. She said, I'm not the pastor. Amen. But she's there by my side, and I want to tell you, I need her. She does what I can't do. She goes where I can't go. She ministers where I am unable to minister because I can't minister to the women the way she ministers to the women. I'm not a woman. I don't think like women think. She understands them. I still can't figure them out. Right, guys? I tell me one time I've been married to my wife 50 years, I still don't understand that. I thought it was joking, right? So I don't know. My grandson came down Saturday and we went to Mother Donner banquet here. I said, come on, let's get out of here. What can you do to learn that? Stay away from where the women get together. You're just yourself in trouble. They're just, but I can't minister what she can. I need her. But she also understands she's not the pastor. Right? And because there's one place where she can minister better than I can. There's other areas of ministry she ministers just as well as I minister. And the altar God gives to her. I want her to be up here. Ladies, we want your giftings to be utilized. And don't let anybody walk out of here saying Christ is against women in leadership. I'm not against women in leadership, but I do believe that it's the exception, not the rule, according to what I see in the Word of God. We're no longer two in one flesh, but ultimately, I have the final say. Because as a husband, how many understand this? Let me talk about marriage for a minute. How many understand you women don't get the time to watch your family and your husband does? Amen? The Bible doesn't take as an equal to die. Take as an animal, though. You know what? If Adam never ate that fruit, we wouldn't be where we're at. But it was because Eve yielded that now she is under the authority of the man. That was the curse. Your desire will be your husband. That actually is your desire, his position, not him. But he will rule over you. That's the curse. And it came because he was tempted first. She gave in first. But the ultimate punishment, the ultimate curse came not a result of Eve yielding, but Adam yielding. So the husband is the one that is going to give an account to God on behalf of where he leads the family. He can't force the wife to go there, but he can set standards. He's not a dictator. He better not be. He's not a controller to get his way. He better not be. He better be leading in love, dying to himself, to lift her up. Amen? Somebody understand. But ultimately, when you have a husband, my mother and father were in ministry together until the day my dad died. My mother still is ministering. She told me that she was sick, she's still taking. Still on staff at my brother's church. Still in ministry. But she also, when we were growing up, my mother went to Bible school. My mother graduated with my father. As a matter of fact, they got married the day after graduation because you couldn't get married while you were in Bible school. So the day after they graduated, they got married. My father told his last church he went to, the only church, but the last church he went to, he said, when you get me, you get us. But ultimately, it was Dad that was the leader. That didn't mean Mom was not effective and efficient in ministry. And Mom would preach, and Mom would teach. Matter of fact, back in the 60s, he used to teach release time for Brother John on one of his buses. When it comes to religious education, they tried my mother's teaching on that bus, teaching the kids religious education. They worked as a team. Just as a marriage. And that's the way I see ministry. It's like a marriage. I look at myself and Central Assembly as a marriage. I need you, and you need me. If God didn't think that I needed you, or God didn't think you needed me, He never would have merged us together. But God knew my giftings, and He knew your graces, and He knew what He would put together and how it would happen, and that's why He did it. Amen? Is a leader without accountability? No. Every leader has accountability. It's not dictatorship. If I start to become a dictator, you need to throw me out on my ear. This is not my flock, this is God's flock. Amen? But as long as I am the lead pastor, I have to give an account to God as they depart from the soul. I have an account I have to give. The board is not going to give an account for your soul. So with leadership comes responsibility, and it was in Adam that responsibility was given. It was to Adam that responsibility came down the pipe. Amen? Now this is a tough subject to cover tonight, and I'm trying to be gentle, but I'm trying to be biblical. When you read the Word of God, you read it clear. Man was not made for the woman, the woman was made for man. It talks about it in Isaiah. Chapter 6, verse 14, it talks about this year. Let me try to see if I can find it again. I think it's like Isaiah 3:12. Isaiah 3:12. As for my people, children out of their oppressors and women rule over them. O my people, they which lead thee cause thee to err and destroy the way of thy paths. He's saying, in punishment, sometimes I'll let you be led by women, not because women are evil, but because you're behaving like children. And I'm going to show you this because in the Bible days, if you've got to go back to Bible times, it was a patriarchal society. So what does that mean? That meant that it was in charge. They had everything like a princess. So what God do, he raised up brothers. He said, you're in a patriarchal society, but I'm going to show you exactly how far off you've gone. I'm going to humiliate you in your own way of living. According to one or more of the commentators, I know that was God's will. That was providence, you know what I'm saying? It was a gift from the beginning. Does that mean that Deborah was not a good judge? Deborah was a great judge. But again, it comes back down to roles, biblical roles. Not equality, not value, not ministry itself. But so yes, women can serve you as the ambassadors, but I believe it to be the exception and not the rule. When you look through scripture, who do you see pastoring the churches? Men. When you look through scriptures, there are occasionally women mentioned in leadership, but rare. That's not my writing like that book, and I'm not one of the it's because I want it that way. It's because that's what God's word teaches me. Now, I did go to this church every November and I minister there, and one of the things I go there for is to minister to the men. This pastor who's been there 40-some years now, since he started it, he is the one that began it. And you know what? We have just had that lady for a while. Most of our ministries that got started by women. You know why? Because men wouldn't pick up the mantle and carry it. And so women came along and started doing the job, and the Pentecostal movement has a lot to thank women for. Amen. Those who've been around Pentecost any amount of time, you know that our roots are often found with the women. It was the women that stepped up. And I remember as a kid, it was the church was usually full of more women than men. Women were more tender to God, amen? Women would come when men wouldn't come. And so God used women a lot. And I thank God for women because if it weren't for women, there wouldn't be a church today. I'm not talking about just sisters, I'm talking sisters because women carried the load for a long, long time while men were out doing their thing. A lot of men didn't go to church back in the day, but the women came along and they brought their husbands in. Finally, the husbands would get a touch of the Holy Ghost, get saved, and get delivered, but it was because of a faithful wife that the husband got saved. Amen? Women, I'm trying to tell you this, we need you. I'm not trying to tell you we don't need you. But I'm dealing with a question. People ask me often, Pastor, how do you feel about women in ministry? It's not about women in ministry. Women belong in ministry. The question you're really asking me, if you want to get down to it and get honest, is what about women in leadership? Which brings a whole different question. Amen? And that doesn't come down to bigotry or chauvinist or women's rights. It comes down to roles, biblical roles, in the family, outside the family. Amen? And so if you have more questions, you can come to me and I'll give you all the scripture you need. I'll take you through the Word of God and I will preach it. But you can read in there that God has called men to give an account. put a woman in. And God was driven to be there for the man. I couldn't make it without my wife. This ministry in this church would not be what it is if I didn't have Jennifer by my side. Amen? Absolutely. It wouldn't. I don't come in here as a lone ranger. I don't come in here as a one-man man. Amen? She adds so much to the ministry of the church, and I thank God for her. But she also understands that I have to give an account for where we go and what we do. And that falls on me. Amen. And when it comes to joint leadership, I lean on Pastor Brendan and Pastor David for counsel. And we talk and we share. And I don't think because I had years of ministry under my belt that they can teach me something. This is an area that I am not qualified in, that they are. And we discuss things every Monday. We meet for staff every Monday. The three of us get together. And we talk about things. I don't dictate, we talk. Amen? And that's the way it would be in any ministry. In any ministry. But it's got to be one thing. There can't be two things. And so, I just see this through the years and people ask me, and I'll just tell you the way I feel, amen? God did use Deborah. He kept his women in these positions. But I want you to know that he's the exception more than the rule. Amen? And I'm passing through the other way, so I'm going to give you an answer for the rule. Any other questions, any comments you want to make, anything you want to ask me right here? I'm right here asking right now. I'm not here to try to force my opinion on you, but I'm just here to what the Word declares. And the word is clear on leadership. It's not a difference in value, it is a difference in rules. Just either male or female, if the ground is level and powerful. And women, you can do things in ministry that we may can't do. You're needed. You're wanted. We desire. We care that you're here. We want you here. This is not a man's world. Amen? This is a family of God. Hallelujah. Husbands, wives, sons, and daughters. Amen? Everybody is necessary. That's the point I'm trying to bring out tonight. In our text, it wasn't the men only that were involved in the work. This gentleman and his daughters working with him. There were women involved in the work of the ministry, and today we are not going to have a complete work of the ministry without women. There will not be a totality of the work of the ministry without the women. We need you. Amen? That's the bottom line. You are needed, you are wanted, but the roles are different. And what I'm going to do is, if you want to talk to me, let's talk about Scripture. Because whatever I'm going to teach you, I'm going to teach you out of the Word of God. And if you want me to, I'll go back and bring in all my Scriptures. And we can go through them one at a time, and you can show me your Scriptures to validate what you feel if you're feeling that I'm not teaching properly. Because I'm willing to be shown in the Word of God where I'm wrong, but as a shepherd, I've got to lead the flock, and this is one of those issues that we don't like to bring up because it can be controversial, but we don't sidestep it because I want you to know what the Word says. And then when you look at the examples in the Word, and you look at the scriptures in the Word, you see what we're talking about. Amen? That does not exist. It does not remove a woman from the ministry. It does not take a lady out of a place of working in the house of God and for the work of the Lord. And not at all. You're included, you're needed, you're wanted, you're desired. Amen. That was a tough place to deal with tonight, a tough issue to deal with. But we're not going to sidestep the difficult issues. Amen. wouldn't like to be the pastor if I feel every time there's different types of information. Amen? We need to know where the Word of God teaches, what the Word of God teaches, and where I stand. Amen? If you pastor, it's the rest of what you're doing tonight. You have questions that you want to come and talk to me about, come see me in the office. I'm more than open, more than happy to share. And we can go through it more in depth at that time. Amen? Father, I pray that God would take, Lord, the Word of God and make it come alive. God, this is a tough subject, a difficult issue. But God, your Word deals with it directly and completely. And Father, maybe that five steps straddle. Lord, take our own viewpoint, God. May it not be a matter of opinion, but may we read from the Word of God. And may we declare what you have said and what you have stated. Father, we live in a day where, God, we tend to take what society thinks over what God thinks. And Lord, I pray, God, that, Lord, we would keep the standard of the Word of God as our standard. And God, we allow you to be God. Father, your will be done. We pray tonight.